You know, you better hide some of this stuff. These guys might take it back and use it for the race team.
Dick, tell her food is what we're after.
Food is what he's after.
It's nice, isn't it?
Yeah, real nice.
Because I asked him the same thing. I said,
first time I've ever been in one.
Well, me too. They have one in Myrtle Beach.
But. And I made a pact with myself that I was going to get me a job when I got to be 85.
85.
85.
Yeah.
And I mentioned that.
You're working on that.
I'm working on
that. Send out for extra makeup for me and Steve.
Oh, yeah.
A lot. If they got some color back, I swear that would be Leonard.
I think so, too. What's with the rouge?
She looks so pretty.
What are you going to do about Beatty there on top?
By God, I mean, she can't do much about me.
Yeah, put the embalming fluid on me.
That's right.
Judy, you look beautiful.
I've heard it. Hey, you're not proposing, are you?
No, I'm not proposing at all.
Get you out of nursing home or what?
What are you doing, Doc? Well, I figured I said, well, I knew Bobby would be the last one here.
They get you out of nursing home or what? We had a good
I told everybody an hour ago, I said, the last person walking that door is going to be Bobby Oliver.
Well,
I said, when he dies, they're going to have to hold the funeral up 30 minutes for
well,
him
I was
to get
the
there, he's going to be late.
The guy out there thought I was somebody got my autograph.
The only way you can tell Red Flying is his lips are moving.
Now, Smokey doesn't start that stuff. We got to have to tell some stories on TV in here now.
Oh, yeah.
Some we can tell, some we can't.
Are y'all taping? Am I at the right place? Am I right place?
And every race driver I've ever met is a pretty good storyteller. They learned that in self-defense.
I think, I look okay? Yeah, I think I look pretty good. I think my wife would be proud. My children, mom and dad, Michael, my brother. I think everybody don't think I look real. I think compared to the other guys. Here we go now.
Welcome to that Fast Car Cafe in Nashville, Tennessee. What would happen if you put together the guys that built the cars with the guys that drove the cars, with the inspector that tore down the cars, with the writers that wrote about it, and the announcers that announced it? You're about to go behind the scenes and hear the stories directly from the legends that lived them. These are the guys that made racing what it is today. Let's walk through the tunnel and join 24 stock car racing legends.
Hey, I heard y'all had a driver's meeting here.
That's
cool.
But I ain't got here.
That's a long man. It's a long way from Plano.
You were talking about some of the different things people did early on, it being a lot more fun and a lot looser. And earlier I was signing those flags, and Ned and you guys were talking about Bondi's operation. And I need to tell you this story, because the other night at a practice session, Robert Yates and myself was talking about it. Of course, everybody knows Robert owns Dale Jarrett's car, 28 and 88 cars now, a very successful operation. He was telling his son about this, and he said the first real job he had in Winston Cup racing was he was a gas man on my car when I drove for Bondi Long in Darlington. And anybody that knows that crowd, by the time I got to them, they were real loose. You know what I'm saying? I mean, we really was loose. And so he said he'd stayed awake all week getting ready for that big event, you know, big league auto racing. He was just worried that he wasn't going to be able to get that gas in that can, you know, fast enough, get it in that car. Started the race, and Bondi decided we was all going to be flower children. See, he played the guitar, and he had all these old records by Iron Butterfly, way before any rock and roll in this kind of business. So we found these big old yellow flowers, sunflower decals, and we put them on the side of the car, and we put them up on the pit board and put it up on the pole in the pits. And this was a Ford factory car now, and all the Ford people were looking at that thing. You know, we had these flower powers, and we was going to get over to all these people that we were peace. You know, we believed in peace, and that was the kind. And, you know, Yates, he was looking at that deal, man. He was just shaking his head, and we said, well, it was the new us. You know, we were at peace with the world. And first pit stop I made, whatever it did, it, we had to pick up a different kind of set of tires or something. There wasn't any radios, and they put the same tires back on the car that I stopped for. That's back when Firestone Goodyear was in. And the next pit stop they come in, Robert was telling his son he was gassing the car, and there all us peaceniks were, and he was gassing the car. And when he got through just in time, jerked the can up, he looked, and the crew chief, myself, was fist fighting. The car hadn't even come off.
And we was a peacemaker.
Yeah, we was a peacemaker. We were two rednecks just fighting away.
Boy, those father and son stories, so good. And you got to, buddy, you got to tell about Fox down at Daytona when you were testing.
Well, first off, let me say Ray Fox Jr. is no longer alive, and he was a very, very personal friend of mine and had a lot to do with my actual starting to win in Winston Cup racing. But anybody that knows Ray Fox knows that he can get a little mad at you. Every once in a while, he'll let you know exactly. He chased David down through the pits with a hammer before, and he's, you know, he's a pretty spirited guy, but he wanted the best. And we're running a tire test one day, and going down the back straightaway, I feel the motor starting to seize up. So I shut everything down and coasted into the garage area. They pulled the hood up, and they said, "What's wrong?" And I said, "Well, the motor's seizing up, and I don't know. I just know it's seizing up." Me being a great mechanic anyhow. So he said, "Raymond, get your screwdriver and go over here and put it down on that valve cover and have him crank it up." I said, "I'm not cranking it up. It's going to blow up if I do." He said, "You want to drive my car?" And I said, "Yes, Ray, I do, but it's blown up. I'm not going to crank it up. It'll explode." He looked at me and he said, "I'm telling you, crank it up. Raymond, put the screwdriver down on the valve cover." So he went like that. I went, "Boom, boom." And he says, "You've killed him." Raymond had to go to the hospital. He had a bunch of stitches in his head. It had melted a piston, and it fired right back through there. And I mean, it knocked his kid 30 feet in the air. I learned my lesson on that. I said, I'd rather get fired than never do that again.
Ray is now head of the Vintage Club racing thing with a lot of members in Daytona when it meets and all. And I keep involved with him. I do some little diecast work and all with him. And he's still the same character. Exactly. I mean, I'm telling you, he has not. And I tell you, if we would have all known, if we would have just had a movie camera, Buddy remembers, Tiny Lund drove for Ray Fox one time, and boy, if you think that wouldn't have made a good movie, you know what I'm saying? But he is active, and him and Smoke in them, and they do a good job with what they do. And you'd be surprised how many people are involved with that thing, and it grows every year. It gets bigger and bigger, and that's good to see that there's some people interested in the sport like other forms of sports where they do care about the past, and they bring it in front of us. I think the older cars, which some of us have restored, and those folks being around is really important. I'm glad to see that. I'm glad they do it.
Did you ever have the guts, Barney, to walk up to Buddy Baker before qualifying and interview him?
Oh, God.
Baker, I never did until Baker after qualifying was done.
Y'all make me sound like I live under a bridge. And if somebody crosses the bridge, I yell at them. I mean, come on. Just was real intense.
Real close.
Harry Hyde told me one time, he said, if you've had anything to tell Buddy Baker, you better tell him on Saturday, because if you try to tell him on Sunday, you can forget it.
Buddy, why'd you always put your uniform on at like 8 o'clock in the morning?
I didn't want to have to fuss. Yeah. I didn't want to have to fuss with the zipper if it didn't come.
First time I seen it, I thought I was late for something. I seen him walking around about 8 o'clock in the morning. I said, "What am I supposed to be doing?"
He's ready to go all the time.
Right there.
Trying to do something on that. Y'all got me sweating. Let's get on somebody else.
Baker almost ended my career before it started. He may not even remember this, but I was a disc jockey at a small radio station down in Elkin back in 1958 and 59. And I used to go to the races simply because we got free tickets, so I'd end up going to Martinsville. And I was doing a sports show, so I decided, you know, heck, I'm here. I might as well get a couple of interviews with some of these guys and use it on the radio. He was the first guy I ever went up to and interviewed. And you may remember this, you may not. But I walked up to him and asked him some dumb question. I have no idea what I asked him. But Baker has a little bit of a lisp, as we all know.
Yeah.
So he answered the question, and I thought he was putting me on by lisping like that. So the next question I asked, I started lisping back. He got a little red in the face, answered whatever I asked him, and I did it again. And you turned around to him and said, "Son, I'm about to put this tape recorder somewhere where you won't be doing no more interviews the rest of the day. Because if you do, the people will be in an odd position you're talking about." But it like scared me to death. I didn't know what was going on. But I didn't know for a long, long time that he had a little bit of a lisp. I thought he was just pulling my leg.
No, no.
As corporate oriented as we were, Buddy and myself was driving for Dodge, and we were on a promotional tour in Daytona, and this lady was interviewing him from a television station, and he just recently, it hadn't been long, bought this other car. And, you know, we should have been promoting Dodge or Chrysler products, whatever it was, and the lady was asking about it, and she said, "Well, those cars are wonderful cars, aren't they? They're really good." And he said, "Lady, I don't have one of them things. I drive a Cadillac."
Let me tell you a story on Buddy, being that we're talking.
Uh-oh. When I see first, what you done?
When I first got a decent ride at Daytona, I wanted to go practice. Well, Buddy was driving for Ray Fox then, and I was told, if Buddy was on the racetrack, don't go out there.
I said, well, why not? Ronnie, I was told the same thing about you.
And I said, "Why not?" I said, "He runs fast." I said, "I need to go out there and run with him and learn." They told me, "Don't go out there." I won't. The man is not here anymore that told me this, that I drove for, Banjo Matthews. So anyway, I'm standing around there one day, and Buddy and I became pretty good friends, you know, right off. We talked a lot and everything like that. He said, "I don't understand." He said, I go out on the racetrack, going to drive with some people." He said, "They might run a half a lap, and then they all quit and come in." And I said, "Buddy," I said, "they told me you was crazy not to go out there and draft with you." I said, "That might have something to do with it." And I'll never forget that, as long as I live. He stood there, and he was very, very good shape, tall, and didn't have any excess fat on him or anything like that. And he looked down at me, and he said, "I'm not crazy." Well, yes.
I'm still up in the air.
But I didn't go out and draft with him.
Craziness does not stay among you guys or on the track. I mean, craziness can be with that Quinella that's sitting back up there. Mm-hmm. Steve, Wade, Higgins. What about you guys up there in the press box? I suppose you just sit there, write all that stuff. Nothing ever happens to you.
Oh, no,
it's all boring.
We'd have to play little mind games. Or we'd play just regular games, like we'd hear Eli on the radio, "Now let's go down in the pits and have an interview with Richard Childress." And we'd go, "Oh, this is going to be profound," you know, something like that. You know, wait and see what they have to say. And the way you looked at it was, I think that you found that these guys had personalities. And if you were a good reporter, you reported what they did, but you reported who they were. And these guys have such great stories to tell that go beyond racing. All of them go well beyond racing. There's Darryl one time got very, very vocal with me, and we were sitting in Bristol, and he told me the story about how he was in a car with a bunch of his buddies on a very cold and still night in Owensboro, Kentucky, and they came tearing through the city streets with the cops chasing them, full bore. And they got out in the countryside, and Darryl was running through the cornfields and everywhere else, and they finally lost the police. Now, sometime in the early morning hours of dawn, for example, I think it was about dawn, yes, it was, this car comes chugging back into town, beaten, worn up, corn ears sticking all around it and everything, and it comes to a stop behind some place, but it's all by itself. Darryl gets out of the car, looks around like that, and then runs off. Now, Darryl told me the story, and then he added the punchline that you probably wouldn't think other people would tell you. He said, "Oh, yeah, at the time I was 15 years old and I didn't have a driver's license." So the thing that was really good about dealing with these athletes was that they transcended the sport. They went and told you something about themselves. And when they gained your confidence, as I think most of these guys here have, they would confide, you know, there would be secrets they'd confide in. They'd confide about their personal lives. What should I do? Ask your advice, things of that nature. And you'd do the same to them. So it became more than just a one-on-one professional relationship. It became a personal relationship as well.
We never did anything that we couldn't talk about.
Now, wait a minute.
Buddy and Dave and I share a love of the outdoors, and we developed relationships along that line, especially fishing. In fact, Marcus taught me how to, being from Wisconsin, he knew how to ice fish. And lakes in North Carolina mountains froze over thick enough one time to ice fish up there. So Dave and I went to Grandfather Lake up at the foot of Grandfather Mountain, and we're going out on the lake to ice fish, and it was 22 inches thick. Dave said you could have driven a trailer truck on it, but I was still walking pretty gingerly. I didn't want to fall through the ice. And Dave had this huge sleigh, like a children's sled or sleigh, that he was pulling along, and it was piled high with gear. And I couldn't imagine needing that much gear to go ice fishing out on Grandfather Lake.
Drop a line through a hole.
Yeah. Right, yeah. And I said, Dave, what's all the stuff on the sleigh? And he said, that's lunch. Marcus is known for his appetite. He took a propane gas stove out there that was on the sleigh and fixed hamburgers in the middle of Grandmother Lake in the North Carolina mountains. And we've had some good times outdoors.
We caught
some
fish.
Yeah, we caught some fish. And then another time, Buddy and I were at Cape Lookout on North Carolina coast fishing, and we were having very, very good luck catching speckled trout. And Buddy thought that he could do a little bit better if he waded out to a spit of sand and cast from there. And so he did, and he was catching so many fish that he was unaware that tide was coming in. And pretty soon he's waist deep, and all of a sudden a large fin appears in the water between Buddy Baker and the shoreline. And it's a shark. And Buddy cast in, we're fishing cut mullet, and the shark hit his cut bait, broke the line. But even with the hook in its mouth, it's still feeding. I'm thinking it's starting to circle Buddy Baker. But Buddy was real clever. This was one time he didn't panic. You know, they talk about him panicking, you know. He kept his wits about him and did something very, very smart. He had the cut bait in a pouch in his waders, and he took every bit of it in a handful like this, threw as far as he could. The shark turned, go get the bait. Buddy Baker came across the top of the water. It is absolutely true. A man can walk on water. I saw Buddy Baker do it. And came back to the shoreline, and he has not been back to Cape Lookout since.
You've covered so many different sports. What is it about this one that brought you back for so many years, and you turned out so many great stories for the Charlotte?
The people. The drivers and crew chiefs and team owners are more cooperative than any people in any other sport, and more interesting to write about. And they made it a dream job. They really did. It wasn't hard to cover at all because of the personalities and just good people. Made easy to cover.
Our Zimmo cars back in there
had
about 600 counts of drag or more. Yeah, these cars now.
Wide cars.
Put them back like that.
And now they're down to 300 and some. Used to in old Monte Carlos or something, it'd be like following a big old barge down the water.
Yeah.
Right. And put a big old wake out. Now it's like following a little small speedboat.
Yeah. Look how them 74s used to draft. They wouldn't run a lick, but boy, in a race.
Widen them things back out like the Monte Carlos were.
Which ones are we going to bring back, the old Monte Carlos or the old wide forward?
Well, they're
leave
the same.
One, leave your forward slick and bring the old Monte Carlos back.
Why would you want to do that?
That way you'll break up that.
Let me tell you another thing, too. We got 750 horsepower. You know how much business we got with 750 horsepower?
Not a bit.
You got guys coming out of the truck series and the bush series that got 500 horsepower.
What you need to throw do them is out take there in the restrictors cars. Off at Talladega. You can take the
You
bush
can do it at Talladega.
Yeah, you need to take them off at Talladega.
Daytona might be a little treacherous, but.
Go 245 at Talladega.
That'd be good.
But they don't ever talk about reducing cubic inch or nothing. Right.
Well, they got too much horsepower.
Yeah. I know that.
Darrell, I'm sitting up in the press box at Martinsville with Billy. This is last year. And he's saying, Donnie, I got to do something to make the Grand National cars more like the Winston Cup cars. You know, wheelbase or something. I said, no, Billy. I said, if you want to do that, put a big carburetor on it. I said, what the problem is the guys get out of the late models on Saturday night, or they get out of the Busch car or out of the truck into a Winston Cup car, and the first time they match the throttle down, they're so scared it takes a week for them to get their breath back.
It does. That's exactly right.
And I said, the problem of it is, and like we've had over the last 5 years anyway, open wheel drivers or, you know, IndyCar drivers or sprint car drivers come in and do reasonably well because when they drive their car and step on the throttle, they accelerate.
They have that kind of power.
And we don't have them.
Right.
I said, back when we got out of late models, talking about Bobby and you and myself, we had engines back then that probably accelerated better than the Grand National cars, they were called at that time.
Yeah.
You know, once cars did it. It never scared me when I matched, except a couple of times I stepped on Junior. but it really, it's what I felt like the problem is, more than anything else, is that all the other divisions don't have horsepower.
Right.
And when they get in a Winston Cup car, it's got so much horsepower.
When the Busch racing was the best, I mean, when it was, you could buy a Winston Cup car and go run it in the Busch series. You could buy a motor from Junior or whoever, and that motor would, there was parity there, you know. You could race on Saturday and get that car and race on Sunday, and you didn't know the difference. But now it's just too big a change.
You're right.
These engines that we have today, 750 horsepower, man, I'm telling you what, they're hard to control.
Absolutely.
And when a guy nails that throttle and he gets them old radial tires all heated up, and he nails that throttle, he ain't got a clue where it's going to end up. Except he hits the guy beside him and he says, I don't know, somebody took the air off my spoiler. Yeah. That's all I hear. I mean, I don't know why I even got spoilers on them, because people always taking the air off of them. It's like a rock.
That's just part of the new language.
See, you're the only one that's ever experienced that. Yeah. The rest of us,
there's two things I ain't quite forget. Well, it's just racing, and somebody took the air off my spoiler.
Y'all only
and the spoiler is that big.
Yeah.
And I didn't know there was that much air out there.
That's the single one complaint that the fans have today is what they see at Daytona and Talladega to them is not competition, it's a parade. Yeah. And what they're saying is the ones that used to see it in the days when there were non-restricted engines said that's the way it was. A man had a chance. A man didn't have to rely on somebody else to pull out and make a pass. A man could use strategy. You still saw plenty of passing. And now what they're seeing is a big train with everybody scared to death to make a move unless because somebody won't help them. They're stuck. They go all the way back.
You still had big wrecks back then, even unrestricted.
But the wrecks are not the issue. The issue is the competition, that nobody is doing any significant amount of passing. You could see 3-4 passes a lap back in the 70s and the early 80s without the plate. You're always going to see the wrecks with or without the plates.
But how do you reconcile the fact that the fans never sit down and they build 20,000 new seats at a clip?
It's the only game in town. It's the only game in town.
Well, mainly it's the wrecks. You take the wrecks out of the race at Charlotte Sunday, and what did you have?
Not much.
Not much.
What did you have? You had one car leading everybody else around.
And plus, we were watching Darrell come.
Yeah, well, that was exciting. I don't know about it. Well,
I had seatbelts and all that.
How did you do that anyway?
Huh?
How did you do that anyway?
I got up in that champions groove, man, up in that high champions groove.
Did they let you tune the engine that morning?
I had one of Junior's carburetors.
Yeah. Cut it in half. Yeah,
cut it in half. Yeah,
it certainly looked like you had
one of Junior's carburetors.
But you know one thing, you can run better without the big horsepower, like you were running, than if you had the big horsepower.
Oh, yeah. The horsepower is not the issue. Don't want to bring up any bad subjects or not, but if we think back to 1983, we know what tires versus horsepower do.
Yeah.
Absolutely. Raise them up about 4 inches and just leave them the way they are.
No, downforce is the driver's best friend. That's the thing that people that don't drive don't understand.
When you get the other end,
bog them down with downforce. Stick them in the ground, make them where they won't hardly budge.
Right, then you'll see some racing.
And then you can drive them.
You got to put the drag in
them. You got to put the drag in them.
Yeah, but how can you give them downforce without adding speed?
Oh, downforce takes away speed. The bigger spoiler you put on it, the slower it'll go. That's why we set track records now. They cut the spoilers down, raise the front up, everybody fixed the front, got a 5-inch spoiler, set a new track record. put a 7-inch spoiler on it, and you'll be 2 seconds slower than the track record.
Make much better racing.
Much better. You know, Bobby, from old Camaros and all, the more blades you put on them, they wouldn't go down the straightaway, but they'd sure go around the corner.
Yeah.
So, I mean, they got them so freed up, they got 300 counts of drag, you got a 5-inch spoiler, and a body that's a little bitty. They just go like bullets.
Well, gentlemen, now you see why I thank the Lord every day I'm retired.
Well, what y'all do is widen them back out about 64 inches. We got big old fat fenders.
64-inch tread, yeah. Open grill.
Open grill, that'd work. Any like kind of drag.
Need to get Beatty to come out of retirement.
Big spoiler on the back. Left. It just slows you down. Yeah.
Is Dick Beatty's fault?
Well, is
could have been.
He retired.
I'm gone.
That's retired. Problem. That's what's wrong.
Well, Darrell, is the answer as simple as an engine with less horsepower and a bigger spoiler? Is the answer
that
simple?
Right there you got it.
That sounds simple, though.
Definitely is.
Well, haven't we tried it? Why hasn't it been tried?
In theory, they say, we'll put a smaller spoiler on it, it'll go slower. But that shows how ignorant you are about drag and what it does in a wind tunnel. Take the spoiler off, but what did Baker tell you? In 1970 or whatever it was, you take the spoiler off, you pick up 300 RPM.
Yep.
So if you take it off and pick up 300, what would if it stuck it way up in the air, what would happen? You'd lose 600.
That's that.
Plus, you'd nail the race car down.
Probably one of the best races at Charlotte the other night was that ARCA race. They got like 6.5 inches of spoiler, 4 inches in the front, less horsepower, and them young guys was out there running side by side for 4 or 5. That's probably the best race.
But wait a minute. Now look at this deal we got coming up at Talladega. We got a big spoiler. Pretty big spoiler. Less horsepower. What do you do with the cars? They're fixing the cars. They're shaking your guts out of you now. They're going to kill somebody with that.
They made a rule to slow us down.
Yeah.
And if you even go further than that, why do they give us 2 laps to do it? I mean, we want to go, you know, you give me one, just let me go through this misery for only 1 lap.
Yeah. I mean,
they want to be sure the older drivers can hold their breath 2 laps.
I can't.
Well, now it's whether
I'm going to take oxygen all week long just so I have a little extra built up.
Well, now it's whether your insides can stay together long enough.
Drivers leave Talladega and Daytona with their kidneys torn up, their backs hurting.
Yeah,
I mean, that's terrible.
2 weeks ago, I tested at Daytona for Richard Childress. That one car, Dale's, with that soft seat in, I wouldn't even drive it no more the second day. You can't.
But yet, why do we let them keep on with what we do?
Well, you understand who has the ball.
Not us.
You understand whose ball it is, don't you? And we're going over to their house, and it's their ball.
Clinton's still in office, ain't he?
So,
pretty good. Different kind of balls there, but
There's one thing that has never changed. With him, all these guys are in this room right now. In 1971 or two, I was at Charlotte, North Carolina, sitting on a dirt bank drinking a cold beer after the race at Charlotte, and we were talking about the rules, the purses, and the cars and how unfair everything was. That was what we were talking about in 1971.
In 1998.
1998. We're still talking about the same things.
I got the best thing going.
But you're right. They make a rule that's good, and then they let you do something that's bad.
A good example of that is all the plumbing that we all went through in the manifold.
Yeah.
They went to a restrictor plate to slow us down. Then they allowed us to go inside the manifold and spend $500,000 trying to trick the plate.
How much do you know?
Why did they do
that?
Like,
yeah.
What do you think, Harry? But you're right. I mean,
I want to say one other thing about restrictor plate racing. Have you ever been to a restrictor plate race where you wasn't sure the other guy wasn't cheating?
Oh, don't look at me.
Has there ever been a race won at a restrictor plate race yet that you didn't think that guy was probably cheating?
Oh, absolutely.
Whoever wins, you think he's cheating.
When you see a car at Daytona and Talladega lead the race and nobody can pass him, I promise you, he's cheating.
He's cheating. Absolutely.
When you can't pass somebody, he's cheating.
That's right. If you got 42 cars.
Is that how you won all them races?
I didn't win them all on restricted plates.
Yeah, but you won them. It's the same theory.
Let's talk a little bit about, we talk about the sport and the sport growing and stepping up in stature. How many of you guys went to the White House the first time NASCAR was there? What was that like?
Well, I thought it was just really special, you know, that our industry was invited to the White House by the President of the United States, who, especially that particular one, was a pretty good one, you know. And you know, we had a lot of regard for him, but we had a lot of regard for what the White House really was. And so we were able to go there, you know, put our tuxedos on and go mingle with that part of this world or that part of this country. And it was just really special, I thought.
I wish Pearson was still here. He could talk about drinking beer with Billy Carter. But
I walked in and the first thing the president said to me as I got there was what a great fan he was of our sport. Yeah. And Jimmy Carter was a friend of all of the race drivers. He had followed the sport. He knew each and every driver. His wife made us feel very comfortable there. It was a long ways from going to Columbia, South Carolina with a 40 Ford and running for less money than you get now to crank up and even start a race if you won. And to be at the White House with, I mean, it was, to me, a bridge that we crossed that made our sport go that next level up.
Legitimize the sport even some more so. Yeah.
It was the first time it was taken out of its element and put into a national arena that the national press could not ignore. It was on page one of the Washington Post and the New York Times the next day.
And he was thoughtful enough, or the administration was thoughtful enough to bring Willie Nelson.
I was fixing to say, he came to Atlanta Racetrack every race that was ran, okay? And I did talk to Jimmy Carter when he was the governor of Georgia at Atlanta Racetrack. He says, when I become president, I'm going to have you people to the White House.
Yeah.
Well, I mean, this is a statement. Oh, sure. Okay.
Right.
When I get to be Richard Childers, I'm going to ride around number three.
Yeah.
But he became president, and by golly, we all win. And it was quite a thing for the racing people to be invited up there and then to have Willie Nelson come entertain.
Yeah.
And it was fabulous.
Clint was having a little problem there.
Well, he when he was governor, he says, if I get elected governor, I'll invite you to the governor's mansion. And then after that, he would invite us to the White House. And then it was our car, Junior's car, Richard Petty's, and Bobby Allison's, I believe. All four cars on the White House lawn.
Right.
And Rosalind says, I want them cranked up and drove up and parked in front of the door. Yeah. And they says, well, it'll break all the china. She says, I don't care. Crank them up.
You know, I think that my wife, May, said it best. Here's a little Mill Hill girl, Tupelo, Mississippi, in the White House, having her picture taken with the First Lady. Been an awful lot.
Racing family.
Mm-hmm. It proved, too, how effective the Secret Service was, because as we checked in, they detained Tom here for quite a period of time.
I knew you back then, Tom.
Do you remember the awful stunt that Harold Kinder pulled on Jimmy Carter, Atlanta?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
You remember that?
Yeah.
They got ready to, he was running for president. He had a Secret Service fellow with him. And Jimmy Carter was going to drop the green flag. Yeah. Do you remember the story?
Yeah, I know. I told him not to do it.
But he did it.
Anyhow, Jimmy Carter was going to drop the flag, and Harold got there, and he really gave him a bunch of bull manure. He told him, now, you're going to have to, when you get there, cross your legs like that, because the suction of those cars are really causing some problems down there. Jimmy Carter threw the green flag with his legs crossed like this because Harold Kinder told him to lie.
And the best part was the Secret Service guy was standing beside him the same way.
They were really
concerned about old rupture. Well, and Harold was on the back end of the flag stand falling down as usual.
Good thing Tiny Lum wasn't a flagman, huh? He'd been standing on his head throwing.
Well, he'd fall out flags.
Now, I tell you the best thing about going up there is the freedom you had to roam around the whole White House other than the second floor.
The house.
That was the part.
They definitely opened the doors.
Yeah, that was the best part.
Let's talk about beginnings. Let's talk about, you know, these are celebrated names. And folks all over the country know about them. But where did they start? Richard, first car you ever had. First car you ever had, probably Bowman Gray Stadium.
Yeah.
What was it like? How much did you pay for it? What was it?
Buddy and I went in together. I'll tell you how old all these guys are. I used to sell peanuts and popcorn over and watch every one of these guys race. That's how young I really am. So I'm the youngest one.
Now, what are you doing here?
Well, I was just invited. I'm retired. So we bought this 47 Plymouth, paid $20 for it. We split it, flipped the coin, see who got to drive it. So he won. His name was Jerry Cooper. So he won. Went out there, and next week it was my turn. So I got to drive. So I liked it so much, I said, we need another car where both of us can run. God. So we found an old 54 Plymouth and bought it on Saturday morning. It took us that long to borrow the money to give it. I think we gave $40 for it. And we was welding, take coat hangers, trying to weld roll bars in it. We was running out of time because it takes a while to do that. So I said, well, I got to race tonight. I said, let's take some tape these things up after we got them put in there. So we taped in them roll bars and went over and ran the race that night. And so that's how I got started in it. And had a great time and never looked back, no regrets.
Like you say, the first two-car team, you got an extra seven test sessions and everything.
And Cheetah roll bar.
I'm going to tell you about another way something I got started. Back in the 50s, I think it probably 56, something like that, we was running the old Fords, the Y-block Fords. And Homer Warman's my mechanic, and we was running those. You know, when that time, the Ford had a two-bolt plate to held a camshaft in, a little Y-block. So we decided we want to try to build one of those new V8 Chevrolets that just come out, a little 265, I think it was, that year. So my mechanic, we got one, started tearing it down, and as he tore it down, there was no plate to hold a camshaft in, just the timing gear. So he said, that'll never work. Said, it's going to come right out through the timing cover. You've got to have come out of plate to hold it. They didn't send us all the parts or whatever's necessary. At that time, there was a teenager that had an old Chevy, I think 55 Chevy, used to run the drag race. He'd run up down in front of our shop. Had a shop right down there, a little street not too far from us. So I said, well, let's get that kid up here. Maybe he can help us build this engine. He knows about them Chevrolets. He runs them drag races. We got that kid up here, a little teenager, come up there and helped us put that Chevrolet together. First time, went up to Hollywood Speedway, ran second, the first time we ever run that car, and won the next 9 features in a row. And that kid that helped us build that first engine was a boy named Bobby Allison. And Bobby, I think Bobby, that's when he decided, he said, I was having all the fun, getting all the notoriety, he wouldn't get none. So that's when he decided, I think he won the race car driving.
The first time I ever saw driving.
But he had to start out a lot different. He ought to tell you how he had to start out, because he didn't start out driving as Bobby Allison.
First time I went down to Bobby's shop in Hueytown, had old brick building there, kind of set on a creek bank, I believe it was. And I'd never seen a dyno before. I had no idea what that was. And I hear a motor running like somebody's gone crazy, like trying to blow it up. Go in the little room, and it's got a thing called a dyno with an engine sitting there, and Bobby's running it. And you look outside, and all the water's coming out of the creek. They had a hose that ran down into the creek, and it didn't have a water tower or a tank or anything. He was just pulling water right up out of the creek, and he was dynoing his engines in there on a thing called a dyno, which I'd never seen, and a wire welder. I'd never heard of didn't know what a wire welder was. It's coat hangers and acetylene, that's about it.
So who did you race as in the beginning of your career? Well, who were you?
See, several things happened along that deal. You know, first of all, my very first race, I drove my school car out to Hialeah Speedway and raced my school car in the first amateur event they had there. And the third week I won. And I said, boy, this is it, this is my career. A little bit after that, my mom was sure that she could divert me from this dirty fingernail racing kind of thing and send me off to Wisconsin to her sister and brother-in-law who lived there. And brother-in-law was the national sales manager for Mercury Outboard Motors. So, she made this deal with Uncle Jimmy for me to go to Wisconsin. And he said, come on up here and I'll get you a job and all that. So here I was, 17 years old, just out of high school. And I had to drive this boat with this outboard motor on it around the lakes and rivers of Wisconsin all day, every day. And then on Friday, they gave me a paycheck. And they got me away from racing. But see, this was Wisconsin. My first trip ever to Wisconsin. And in the summertime, they race 7 nights a week in Wisconsin.
Yeah, they do.
And Saturday afternoon and Sunday afternoon. And so I had this paycheck. You know, I wasn't driving up there, but then I could borrow my aunt's car and I could go to the races several nights a week. And so I went to Slinger before it was ever paved, and I went to Hales Corners and to Appleton and to Fond du Lac and up there to Wausau and all over the state of Wisconsin.
Was Dick Trickle there?
Is what?
Was Dick Trickle there?
Yeah, he was there.
Yeah, Dick Trickle had been winning for about 4 or 5 years.
Excuse me, go ahead.
Yeah, okay. No, left there and went to the Winter Proving Grounds at Sarasota at the time, and from there got drafted into Keith Kiefer's little race team, or big race team, that was at Charlotte, North Carolina. And I spent 2 months there, and then went back to Miami. And I decided, well, I really had to get back into this racing thing. And so began to struggle around, try to get up another little amateur car. And my mom said, you can't live here and race. So I said, well, it's the easy solution to that. I'll just change my racing name. So I became Bob Sunderman. And so I went off to the races, you know, just no problem. I had my bed at home and my dinner plate at home. And this Bob Sunderman went to the racetrack. And that went on for about a week and a half. And my dad said, if you're going to race, use your own name. Just make sure you do it right. So I said, yes, sir, that means I can come back in the house while I'm racing. Yep, you can. So I was only Bob Sunderman for a very short period of time, but it became very famous because the word got out that I had slipped out and raced under this alias name. I was already beyond Bob Sunderman when I met Red Farmer. You know, I knew who Red Farmer was, but I didn't have any idea that he knew who I was. And I was driving around this, and actually it was a 56 Chevy that I had bought while I was with Keycaver. And really, to be completely honest, you know, I didn't know much about engines. I took them apart and put them back together, and they, you know, nothing hit or banged, or they ran okay, but I didn't know any of the special stuff. But I wasn't going to tell Red Farmer that if he thought I knew something.
He knew that he didn't have a plate to hold cams yet. Yeah. I didn't know that.
When were you B-066-Y? You remember, you told me that you were B-066-Y.
Let me tell you that story.
Yeah.
We were in Montgomery, Alabama. Yeah. We met a man from Tallahassee. Name was Bobby Webster. And he was the first person that made us aware of a roller type of camshaft. When Bobby first came to Alabama, I came as a helper. I didn't drive a modified car. Anyway, this Bobby Webster had about 4 or 5 sons, and he had this one named Steve. And Steve, God bless, he was cross-eyed. He was as fine a little boy as everyone's he alive, but every time he'd stand and look, he would look at you sideways like that. And at that time, they didn't have the eye doctors to straighten all that problem out. And his race car was sitting on the trailer in front of Bobby Webster's little shop. And Steve jumped up on the tire, which was a single axle trailer, right in with the door, and he looked over at the roof. He says, I know what his name is. It's B-066-Y. And that's where that came. And it's the funniest thing. Everybody in the place cracked up, Beryl, because the kid was, it was all honesty, you know.
Oh,
I mean?
He was sincere
and,
about it. Yeah.
And he was sure and that, so, you know, it was so I became B-O-B-B-Y, B-O-B-B-Y, but it was too small B.
Is that where Bobby found out about them roller cams? Yeah. Roller tappets?
Hey, let me tell you about a car. We were getting beat by these cars. We was up in Kentucky, and some of them came down here in Nashville, but these cars from Alabama, they called them, what do you call them, Skeeters or something like that? They were modifieds, you know. And we had 34 Fords, and we had the same kind of cars they had, but their cars were a lot faster than ours. And, man, we couldn't understand why they could be so much faster. They looked like our cars. They all had
we same, just drove them better.
Same axles. Might have had a roller cam. I don't know about that. But anyway, so we finally got around. We finally bought one of them. And we figured out a big, big difference right away. We was using water pipe to make roll bars, and they was using exhaust pipe. That was one of the big differences we found out right away.
David, when you came down from Wisconsin to Daytona that first time, now that was an adventure. As I recall, that was one whale of a story.
Well, it was. I had a 65 Chevrolet truck at the time with a platform on it. And We was headed down to Daytona, and somewhere in Kentucky, the rod started knocking in the thing, started hammering. So I pulled into a rest area, and you know, all I had was a few tools along and a torch and stuff like that. And we drained the oil out of it and caught it in a container that we had, and I had a case of STP with me. And we saved that oil, and we dropped the oil pan off the engine. And there was a rod bearing burned out. So the only thing we could do, we didn't have no way to lift the engine out or take it apart there. So I took that torch and I got the piston hot and got the wrist pin out of it and cut the connecting rod off up in there and cut it off on the other end. And I took silver duct tape, taped up the crankshaft so it would hold oil pressure. And I put that rod back on there and clamped it on there, dumped that old used oil back in it, dumped a bunch of STP in that thing, put it back together, and fired that thing up, and it shook so bad. You could not hold the steering wheel. It just shake. And I drove that truck all the way to Daytona Beach, Florida, like that. And, you know, as we got closer, I guess that old tape got gooey and slimy, and it was getting loose, and the oil pressure was dropping. And when we got there, basically it just had zero oil pressure, but we had a case of STP in it. And we got that race car to the racetrack, and we qualified for the race, and took the truck over to Smokey Unix. And Smokey allowed me to run a drop cord out from underneath his door and work on that truck at night out in the parking lot underneath the roof there. And I took the engine out, and I called Larry Weirs, who was helping sponsor the car at that time and still does today. He owns a Chevrolet dealership up there in Bangor, Wisconsin. And he brought a short block down, and we fixed that thing, replaced the heads and stuff, and Smokey did a valve job on them for us, and we put that engine back together at nights down there in Daytona, and got the thing back together and then went back home. But it was, we didn't have any money to do it any other way. I mean, it just didn't have no money.
How about your how about your beginnings, Harry?
Well, I started in over Hickory Speedway, which was dirt, in a hobby car that some fellas I went to school with was a little ahead of me in school, and they was working on this 51 Chevrolet hobby car. They said, come on down and help us, and we might let you drive it some. So I went down and helped them. We got the thing done, went over to Hickory Speedway, and the guys that really was going to drive the car, Benny Curley, he said, do you want to drive? And I said, no, you go ahead and drive. We argued back and forth. I said, we all got scared we got over there. So anyway, Benny drove, and next week I drove, and we went for the rest of the short season like that. And then the next year, Benny let me drive it all year, which is 1965, and we won the championship, and they promoted you up to the sportsman division. Couldn't run a hobby anymore, so plugged around a little bit, and then built me a real big illegal engine over on that dirt. The guy building engines down there at Statesville, he was winning all the races over there, and I went down to get an engine fixed, and he said, it'd take you 5 years to catch me over here at Hickory. He said, I can fix this engine. Said, you can get it in a year. So he built me a 327/60 over, and he's only allowed 292, and I won a couple races there, you know, and then I think Ned, he come there, and you paved the track 67 or something, and Ned come as the promoter over there, and we won the championship along about the time you got me the first ride in Junior's car, I believe. He said, you want to go to Charlotte and run a Winston Cup car, a Grand National car, and Junior doesn't leave it. I said, never really thought a lot about it, but I said, yeah, it's on, you know, our season was over, and so he took me there and run Junie's car, and we finished real good. In the
yeah, he did good.
500, then he let me run it again at North Wilkesboro, and we finished good. And then we went to Hickory when he run the short track, and so on the outside pole. Buddy, I believe he's on the pole right there in that K&K Dodge. And the drive shaft flew out of that big old Mercury. But he never did harm me, so I figured, well, this ain't for me. You know, I can't get no Winston Cup ride, so I'll just stay what I'm doing. So that's what I done.
He'd have heard you if you told that drive
cam. I still tell him, yeah, he never would harm me. I said, what are you going to do? Whenever
I drive way too hard.
And how about the trip from Porterville, California, to compare to the trip down from Wausau?
Well, it really is an interesting story, I guess, because I never planned anything. I was in a trucking business out there, and when I left California, I left my car in short-term parking at San Francisco Airport. I'd never been on a plane. I'd never been back east. I'd never been out of California except for one time, or for a very extended time anyway. And so And when I left the car there, I was just coming back to just see Rossi about buying a car. Well, I ended up going to Daytona, so it ended up being 2 months. I went back out to get the car. I had an $800 car and a $2,200 parking bill. You know, so so anyway, that's kind of the way it started. But the way I actually started, I bought a 40 Ford with an old Pontiac engine in it, and we ran figure eight racing at Oildale and Marks Bank Stadium over in Hanford. We didn't have any roll bars. We did have some aircraft-type seat belts, no shoulder harness or anything. We'd make an intersection at Marks Bank about 100 miles an hour. And it killed off a couple of those guys, and they finally stopped doing that. Did a little modified thing with a guy named Red Mulligan that is from Atascadero, which is the same track that Ernie Irvin came from. And he's like Red. He's probably ran 2,000 races and probably won 1,500 of them. I don't know, maybe more than that. And so a little bit of that. And then we had a little track in Porterville, and I had a 56 Ford, and I ran 13 races there in 68, and I won 11 of them. And I won all the trophy dashes, and I won all the heats, and I won 11 features. And so this guy that I'd gone to school with made a little money, and he wanted to buy a race car and wanted to know if I wanted to drive it. And so that's how we ended up getting back here. I went down to Daytona, down to Riverside, and didn't go to the race, but I stood outside waiting for people to come out the gate and asking anybody if they had a car for sale. I'd never seen a Winston Cup race or a NASCAR race. And so I asked him if I had a car for sale, finally found out that Rossi did have, ended up meeting with him at a hotel down there in Riverside, came back to Griffin, Indiana, Gary, Indiana, where they was building the Chrysler stuff, and then went with him down to Spartanburg, got a car, bought it through inspection with an extra engine, 69 Plymouth Roadrunner, with two Hemis and the car for, I think, $16,000, I believe. And it was a car that Bobby Ellis was driving, and they were going to Dodge that year. They were going to do the Dodge that year. And so I showed up down in Daytona in Rossi's car. They put it out on the line, and I got it and took it. I'd like to have never gotten a racetrack. I didn't know how to sign up. I didn't know anybody. I didn't know anything. And so anyway, come time to qualify, so we went and qualified. And I think we qualified like 16th or something like that, but it scared them to death. I remember where I met Bobby. He got me, he says, let's go down and eat some lunch. Well, he ended up with his dad, had his dad, and his nephew, which actually built the airplane motors for our big round motors now that's out in Denton, Texas. And so we went down and eat lunch and talked for a while, and just about what you were supposed to do, running that kind of speeds, stuff. And hell, didn't make a difference to me. What are you supposed to do? You're supposed to pass everybody out there. You know, it's what you're supposed to do. You're racing, you're supposed to pass everybody. Well, when we got qualified, we went down to Volusia Auto Parts. And my brother and a friend of mine came back here, and we went down to Volusia Auto Parts and bought four jack stands, a jack, and some regulators and air guns. And so there's a unique story about what happened during the race. During the qualifying race, I got to second. I got up to second place and I spun. And I ended up finishing that 16th. So it started me, I think, in the 500 on 32nd or something like that. And anyway, when I took the thing back home, we took it back to Spartanburg. I never planned on staying. I never thought about it. We just had a race car. And went into a Shell station there on Interstate 85 in Spartanburg, and asked the guy if we could leave the car there for a while. And I did, and he said, yeah, I'd be fine. So piled everything that we had in the car, everything that we owned, put in the car. And my brother and this other guy took off back to Porterville. And there I sat. So I spent a day or so there, and then I got a hold of Banjo Matthews. Somebody told me about Banjo Matthews had a truck for sale. So I went to Banjo's and bought one of the old trucks, the old haulers like we used to have, which was pretty nice hauler in those days. And we bought that. And then went to Rockingham and finished 8th or 10th, won the Rookie of the Race in Rockingham, and that just started one thing to another.
Let me add a little something to that story. I was working turns 1 and 2 for that first race that Dick came to Daytona. And I discovered that day that he must be a hell of a race driver, because he did everything you could possibly do to kill yourself and everybody in the field. And you remember, you honest to God did. You run three wide, four wide, between guys, outside, inside, on the flat. It didn't make no difference. And pulled it off that day. You remember that?
Oh, yeah. Yeah, that, I had a...
You took my breath.
I had a... Well, we just did that in the qualifying race, because in the... What really, really happened was
the car. True. You did that for 10 years.
The car was. But the car was out on pit row, and well, that's a long story. But they went out and adjusted the timing on the car and just made a lap and blew up. So I was out of the 500. And that's the only thing that really kept from killing everybody. That I don't doubt it. I was just, you know, they told me. Everybody told me, you know, you could go wide open around the racetrack, so I went wide open around the racetrack, you know, or you catch somebody, you're going to pass them. And that's just exactly the way I ran the thing. And I really did that most all my life. I didn't change too much. I never really figured it out until 93 or 94, 10 years after I quit racing, that you had to take the checkered flag to win the damn race.
You know what he was then, though, she's a car owner.
I thought you win it every lap. You know,
once he became a car owner, he figured it out right quick. Don't tear up my car.
Eli, Ned Jarrett tells a great alias driver story, too. John Lentz.
Well, when they started building the Hickory Speedway, it was a big thing in the community there. And, I grew up on a farm and working at a sawmill. And you go down to the country store, and all those farmers and sawmillers and say, man, wait till they get that racetrack built. I'll show them out and drive one of those things. Well, secretly, I thought, well, I'm going to try it if I can work me out of way. They were getting the track about ready, and we were trying to get up a little poker game, a little friendly poker game one day, and needed another player and went down to the country store, and John Lentz was down there. And said, John, you want to come play some cards with us? He said, I'd love to, but I don't have any money. He said, if I could sell half interested in this race car that I got here, then I could go. Well, man, that suited me right to a T. I said, how much you want for half interest in that race car? He said, $100. I said, well, I got $100. So I paid him the $100 to get to drive the car. And so we did, running that first race was ever run at the Hickory Speedway. Well, my dad sat me down and had a real long talk after that, because I hadn't told him about going up there to Hickory to race. And the lumber business was growing, and he told me how bright a future I had and how hard it was to associate with those people in the sport of auto racing and try to build any respect like he had worked so hard to do in the community. And so I saw where he was coming from. He said, it's okay to work on them and own part interest in the car if you determine to do that, but he said, let somebody else drive it. So we did. John drove it for a while. John had been a former motorcycle racer, and so he drove it for a while, and one night he got sick, and we didn't look too hard to find anybody else to drive it. And it's pretty dark in the infield up there, you know, and both of us had big noses, so we said we could go over in the infield and change shirts and when we put the helmet on, well, nobody would know the difference. And sure enough, that's the way it was. And I finished second that first night that I drove it, which was my second race, and he hadn't done that well, so we figured I must be the best race driver. So he said, well, we'll just keep doing this. And so I kept driving under the name of John Lentz for, I don't know, several months, I guess, and finally lucked up and won a race. And of course, in a small community like that, the word began to get out, you know, that it was really Ned in that car and not John Lentz. So my dad came to me one day, similar to what Bobby's dad said, if you're so determined to drive one of those things, he said, use your own name and get credit for any accomplishments that you may have along the way. So I was sort of opened up free to go on and race it.
I should have driven under an alias name.
Never thought of
it's
it.
It's not too late.
I think I could change.
Hey, Daryl, tell them the story about the first big car you bought, that one weekend
deal. The bad check car?
Yeah, the bad check car.
I had been racing in the sportsman division of NASCAR for about 6 years and had lucked up and won the championship a couple of times and thought that they'd come knocking on my door to want me to drive a Grand National car. Well, it didn't work that way, so I scrounged around, found a few rides. That was in 1959, and I'd won the championships in 57 and 58. And I'd gone to Greenville, South Carolina one night and driving the 57 Chevrolet, and that thing had run fast, but it wouldn't run long. And sure enough, it broke. And my brother and a friend of ours were with me that night. We were riding back up the road, and I said, I got to change things. I'm not doing my career any good. They said, what are you going to do? I said, well, there's a car that Junior Johnson was driving. It was a 1957 Ford, and it was for sale. And Junior was winning in that car, and I was dumb enough to believe that I could win in it. And I said, they want $2,000 for it. And I said, I'll buy that car. There was a race at Myrtle Beach, South Carolina on Saturday night, one at Charlotte at the old fairgrounds track on a Sunday afternoon, and each of those races paid $950 to win. And I said, I'll go give them a check. Wait, the bank stayed open on Saturday back then till noon. And I said, I'll wait till the bank closes. I'll give them a check. We'll take off to Myrtle Beach, and I'll win those two races, and I'll have $1,900 when the bank opens on Monday morning. And they just laughed. They thought, well, how dumb are you? But I couldn't sleep. I got home and rushed down there the next morning, bargained for that car. I had to get them to let the crew chief and his helper and let me use the truck and all the tools and an extra set of tires and all that I could con the man out of. And I said, well, I'll make my mind up, but I was just really waiting for the bank to close. So when the bank closed, I run down with that check. I said, I've decided to buy it. Let's go to Myrtle Beach. Well, we got down there too late for practice, but we did qualify eighth because it was a good race car. And as the race went on, well, I found myself up there battling with the lead, and it finally got down near the end to Bob Welborn and myself, who was one of the greatest short track drivers there was. And we were switching the lead back and forth about every lap. But fortunately for me, came off the fourth turn, get the white flag, and I happened to be in the lead, and I looked in the rearview mirror, and Bob was headed to the pits. He'd broken a wheel down, so I was home free. And they had, back then, you know, we wrapped the steering to get the grip on the steering wheel so small on those cars back then. And so you wrapped foam rubber around the steering wheel and took electrician's tape to hold the foam rubber on there. And of course that gave you, you know, a softer grip. And as they had just done that to this car, the problem was that whoever put that electrician's tape on there had wrapped it backwards. And as I was sewing the wheel to the left, the tape was sticking out there, and it just started cutting my hand. And they had to put a tourniquet on my right hand after the race was over to stop the blood flow so they could give me the trophy in victory lane. And I was a total wreck. So anyway, we got through with that, stopped at the hospital in Conway, South Carolina on the way back to Charlotte, and they bandaged me up, got the blood all stopped, and put some salve on it, and went to Charlotte, worked the rest of the night on the race car, got it ready because the job was only half done. And we got in the race the next day, and I was motoring along in fourth place. I don't know if I was in condition to finish the race or not, but anyway, fortunately for me, Junior was driving the Wood Brothers car down that day, and I think he had an engine problem. And he fell out of the race, and so saw Junior in the pits, so wheeled in, got him in the car. He went on to win the race. Of course, I got the credit for it, and story circulated around the pits about the bad check. And so Junior wouldn't take any money for it, so I had the $1,900 to cover that check on Monday morning. So that's really how I got started in what is now NASCAR Winston Cup Racing.
Great story. Well, gentlemen, I wish we had more time, but this has been a lot of fun today, and 4 hours have flown by, and we need to do another 4 hours again sometime soon, but it's been a lot of fun. Thanks, everybody, and thank the folks who've put this all on together and have brought us here together, and travel safe, and we'll see you all this weekend in Talladega.
Thanks, very much.
Thank you, guys.
Good enough. What are you going to do about Beatty there on top?
By God, I mean, she can't do much about me.
You're going to sound that like Mr. Queen.
I'll tell you what we did to Harold Kinder.
What'd you do to Harold Kinder?
Go forward one time. We were down at Talladega.
Yeah.
Hot as heck. And CBS, I believe, was doing the show, and they had a makeup girl. And one of the highway patrols says, we'd like to do Harold and Doyle up, and we may take the picture during the race. I said, man, I don't care, do it. And they put all this crap all over them, put eyebrows on, mouth, eyelids. And it was the hottest day it's ever been in Alabama. And when the race was over, they come down, that old stuff had run down the face. It looked like damn chain bars running down. Boy, were they mad.
Well, see, I've been tickled. I had to help look, supposedly.
I see you had a shampoo.
Yeah, absolutely. Leonard, why she doing your hands? You keep them where you're supposed to.
Apparently
it picks
his nose.
Leonard picks his nose.
Watch it, watch it, watch it.
There we go. Dick Beatty wants freebie.
Freebie.
Got it.
All these damn secrets I used to tell him, now he's talking about it.
You heard what he said, sick cure for seasickness was, didn't
you? Yes. Cure for seasickness?
Hug an oak tree.
That's true.
Makes sense to me.
Makes sense. I tell you what, man. When you seasick, you sick.
Yeah.
I was on a damn destroyer during World War II for 3 years.
Oh, no.
Years.
Here we go.
No, I'm not going to tell a whole war story, just a part of it.
You're right, yeah.
And I tell you what, the only thing I could eat was crackers. Half of them I couldn't keep down.
2 weeks.
I tell you what, there's nothing like seasickness.
At first you're scared you're going to die, and then you're afraid you won't.
You won't die.
Yeah, you're afraid you won't die. That's how bad it is.
The only thing worse than seasickness, I think, is gout.
Gout?
Yeah. You get a gout in one of your joints. The gout is something that you don't wish on no one unless you really hate them. But I don't know nobody I hate enough to wish a gout.
I do.
Do you?
Yeah. Can you handle it?
I can handle it.
What do you do? Oh, stick pins in it or what for gout?
Hell no. You take pills and you hobble around like a cripple. You've never had a gout.
It
gets in your joints. You don't have to be old.
Oh.
Young people have it.
The only people I ever heard say anything about the gout is old people.
No, there's a lot of young kids having it.
Well, that leaves me.
They used to claim that eating red meat would cause it, but the doctor said red meat won't do it, because I don't eat that much red meat. I just flat don't like steaks and things like that. I like a hot dog, a hamburger, but I don't like steak.
Huh. You telling me that story about the Japanese fellow? What? You got on some shit and you saw a Japanese fellow.
Oh, yeah, I was on a midship repair party. After the war ended, they wanted me to. There was three of us, a Captain White out of Boston, myself, and another guy. And we were supposed to go aboard this ship to keep sinking. And like I give a damn whether it's sinking or not. And I went over there, we went aboard. And my job, I was an electrician, my job was to go downstairs, go down. Low. And I went down there, and them damn Japs, you know, they hadn't even signed to surrender yet. Them damn Japs was bound all that crap. I said, oh, hell. Then one peeped around the damn corner of a boiler back there. I said, that's the son of a bitch gonna kill me. I'm getting out of here. I got out of here. I said, everything's fine. Got back to ship. I told the exec, I said, I ain't gonna be on the boarding party. Go ahead and shoot me, do what you want. But I ain't going aboard no more damn Jap ships. I quit.
A few weeks after taping these videos, Dick Beatty passed away. We dedicate these videos to his memory.